Hi friends, welcome back to another episode of our Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone read aloud. Today we are going to pick up with the middle of chapter 5, and Hagrid is taking Harry to this special place to go buy all of his school supplies to go to Hogwarts, which is the magic wizarding school in England, I believe. So let's keep reading. All right, so they had just gone into the Leaky Cauldron, which is like a small little restaurant, and Harry seems to think that only wizards and witches can see it. So let's see what happens in the Leaky Cauldron. For a famous place, it was very dark and shabby. A few old women were sitting in a corner, drinking tiny glasses of their beverage. One of them was smoking a long pipe. A little man in a top hat was talking to the old bartender, who was quite bald and looked like a toothless walnut. The low buzz of chatter stopped when they walked in. Everyone seemed to know Hagrid. They waved and smiled at him, and the bartender reached for a glass, saying, "The usual, Hagrid?" "Can't, Tom. I'm on Hogwarts business," said Hagrid, clapping his great hand on Harry's shoulder and making Harry's knees buckle. "Good Lord," said the bartender, peering at Harry. Can this be?" The Leaky Cauldron had suddenly gone completely still and silent. "Bless my soul," whispered the old bartender. "Harry Potter. What an honor." He hurried out from behind the bar, rushed toward Harry, and seized his hand, tears in his eyes. "Welcome back, Mr. Potter. Welcome back." Harry didn't know what to say. Everyone was looking at him. The old woman with the pipe was puffing on it without realizing it had gone out. Hagrid was beaming. Then there was a great scraping of chairs, and the next moment, Harry found himself shaking hands with everyone in the Leaky Cauldron. "Doris Crockford, Mr. Potter, can't believe I'm meeting you at last. So proud, Mr. Potter, I'm just so proud. Always wanted to shake your hand. I'm all a flutter." "Delighted, Mr. Potter, can't tell you. Diggle's the name. Daedalus Diggle." "I've seen you before," said Harry, as Daedalus Diggle's top hat fell off in his excitement. "You bowed to me once in a shop." "He remembers," cried Daedalus Diggle, looking around at everyone. "Did you hear that? He remembers me." Harry shook hands again and again. Doris Crockford kept coming back for more. A pale young man made his way forward very nervously. One of his eyes was twitching. "Professor Quirrell," said Hagrid. "Harry, Professor Quirrell will be one of your teachers at Hogwarts." "Potter," stammered Professor Quirrell, grasping Harry's hand. Can't tell you how pleased I am to meet you." "What sort of magic do you teach, Professor Quirrell?" "Defense against the dark arts," muttered Professor Quirrell, as though he'd rather not think about it. "Not that you need it, Potter?" He laughed nervously. "You'll be getting all your equipment, I suppose. I've got to pick up a new book on vampires myself. He looked terrified at the very thought. But the others wouldn't let Professor Quirrell keep Harry all to himself. It took almost 10 minutes to get away from them all. At last, Hagrid managed to make himself heard over the babble. "Must get on, lots to buy. Come on, Harry." Doris Crockford shook Harry's hand one last time, and Hagrid led them through the bar and out into a small walled courtyard where there was nothing but a trash can and a few weeds. Hagrid grinned at Harry. "Told you, didn't I? Told you were famous. Even Professor Quirrell was trembling to meet you. Mind you, he's usually trembling." Is he always that nervous?" "Oh yeah, poor bloke. Brilliant mind. He was fine while he was studying out of books, but then he took a year off to get some first-hand experience. They say he met vampires in the Black Forest, and there was a nasty bit of trouble with a hag. Never been the same since. Scared of the students, scared of his own subject. Now, where's my umbrella?" "Vampires? Hags?" Harry's head was swimming. Hagrid, meanwhile, was counting bricks on the wall above the trash can. 3 up, 2 across," he muttered. "Right, stand back, Harry." He tapped the wall 3 times with the point of his umbrella. The brick he had touched quivered. It wiggled. In the middle, a small hole appeared. It grew wider and wider. A second later, they were facing an archway large enough even for Hagrid, an archway onto a cobbled street that twisted and turned out of sight. "Welcome," said Hagrid, "to Diagon Alley." He grinned at Harry's amazement. They stepped through the archway. Harry looked quickly over his shoulder and saw the archway shrink away instantly back into a solid wall. The sun shone brightly on the stack of cauldrons outside the nearest shop. Cauldrons all sizes, copper, brass, pewter, silver, self-stirring, collapsible, and a sign hanging over them. "Yeah, you'll be needing one," said Hagrid, "but we gotta get your money first." Harry wished he had about 8 more eyes. He turned his head in every direction as they walked up the street, trying to look at everything at once. The shops, the things outside them, the people doing their shopping. A plump woman outside an apothecary was shaking her head as they passed, saying, "Dragon liver, 17 sickles an ounce, they're mad." A low, soft hooting came from a dark shop with a sign saying, "Eyelops, Owl Emporium, Tawny, Screech, Barn, Brown, and Snowy." Several boys of about Harry's age had their noses pressed against a window with broomsticks in it. "Look," Harry heard one of them say, "the new Nimbus 2000, fastest ever." There were shops selling robes, shops selling telescopes, and strange silver instruments Harry had never seen before. Windows stacked with barrels of bat spleens and eel's eyes, tottering piles of spell books, quills and rolls of parchment, potion bottles, globes of the moon. "Gringotts," said Hagrid. They had reached a snowy white building that towered over the other little shops. Standing beside its burnished bronze doors, wearing a uniform of scarlet and gold, was... "Yeah, that's a goblin," said Hagrid quietly as they walked up the white stone steps toward him. The goblin was about a head shorter than Harry. He had a swarthy, clever face, a pointed beard, and Harry noticed very long fingers and feet. He bowed as they walked inside. Now they were facing a second pair of doors, silver this time, with words engraved upon them. "Enter, stranger, but take heed of what awaits the sin of greed. For those who take but do not earn must pay most dearly in their turn. So if you seek beneath our floors a treasure that was never yours, thief, you have been warned, beware of finding more than treasure there." "Like I said, you'd be mad to try and rob it," said Hagrid. A pair of goblins bowed them through the silver doors, and they were in a vast marble hall. About 100 more goblins were sitting on high stools behind a long counter, scribbling in large ledgers, weighing coins in brass scales, examining precious stones through eyeglasses. There were too many doors to count leading off the hall, and yet more goblins were showing people in and out of these. Hagrid and Harry made for the counter. "Morning," said Hagrid to a free goblin. "We've come to take some money out of Mr. Harry Potter's safe. You have his key, sir?" "Got it here somewhere," said Hagrid, and he started emptying his pockets onto the counter, scattering a handful of moldy dog biscuits over the goblin's book of numbers. The goblin wrinkled his nose. Harry watched the goblin on his right weighing a pile of rubies as big as glowing coals. "Got it," said Hagrid at last, holding up a tiny golden key. The goblin looked at it closely. "That seems to be in order." "And I've got a letter here from Professor Dumbledore," said Hagrid importantly, throwing out his chest. "It's about you-know-what in Vault 713. The goblin read the letter carefully. "Very well," he said, handing it back to Hagrid. "I will have someone take you down to both vaults." "Griphook?" Griphook was yet another goblin. Once Hagrid had crammed all the dog biscuits back inside his pockets, he and Harry followed Griphook toward one of the doors leading off the hall. "What's the you-know-what in Vault 713?" Harry asked. "Can't tell you that," said Hagrid mysteriously. "Very secret. Hogwarts business. Dumbledore's trusted me. More'n my job's worth to tell you that." Griphook held the door open for them. Harry, who had expected more marble, was surprised. They were in a narrow stone passageway lit with flaming torches. It sloped steeply downward, and there were little railway tracks on the floor. Griphook whistled and a small cart came hurtling up the tracks toward them. They climbed in, Hagrid with some difficulty, and they were off. At first, they just hurtled through a maze of twisting passages. Harry tried to remember, left, right, left, middle fork, right, left, but it was impossible. The rattling cart seemed to know its own way because Griphook wasn't steering. Harry's eyes stung as the cold air rushed past them, but he kept them wide open. Once he thought he saw a burst of fire at the end of a passage and twisted around to see if it was a dragon, but too late. They plunged even deeper, passing an underground lake where huge Monsters grew from the ceiling and floors. I never know, Harry said. Harry called to Hagrid over the noise of the cart. What's the difference between a stalagmite and a stalactite? Stalagmite's got an M in it, said Hagrid. And don't ask me questions just now. I think I'm going to be sick. He did look very green, and when the cart stopped at last beside a small door in the passage wall, Hagrid got out and had to lean against the wall to stop his knees from trembling. Griphook unlocked the door. A lot of green smoke came billowing out, and as it cleared, Harry gasped. Inside were mounds of gold coins, columns of silver, heaps of little bronze nuts. All yours, smiled Hagrid. All Harry's. It was incredible. The Dursleys couldn't have known about this, or they'd have had it from him faster than blinking. How often had they complained how much Harry cost them to keep? And all the time there had been a small fortune belonging to him, buried deep under London. Hagrid helped Harry pile some of it into a bag. The gold ones are galleons, he explained. 17 silver sickles to a galleon, and 29 nuts to a sickle. It's easy enough. Right, that should be enough for a couple of terms. We'll keep the rest safe for you. He turned to Griphook. Vault 713 now, please. And can we go more slowly? One speed only, said Griphook. Tomorrow we'll see what happens with Vault 713. Bye, friends.